having famous chefs come to schools and prepare lunches. From poverty to prosperity, the story of school lunches in Japan is a window on Japan's changing eating habits. On this edition of Begin Japanology, we look at school lunches and how they reflect
Hello and welcome to Begin Japanology. I'm Peter Barakan. Our theme for today is school lunches. In Japan, almost 100% of primary schools serve lunch to their students, and so do about 80% of middle schools. Today I've come to Chiba Prefecture, just to the east of Tokyo, to a school lunch distribution facility. In Japan, there are two main approaches to serving school lunches. One is to have a central facility like this that serves a number of different schools. The other is to have on-site kitchens in individual schools. If you take a look at those great big cauldrons down there, each of them holds enough food for about 850 servings. But if you have a look at the size of this giant spatula, I think it'll give you an idea of the scale of what's going on here. They cook food here for about 10,000 children every day. Later on, we'll take a look at the menu for today. But first of all, have a look at how the lunch program runs at a typical primary school.
This is a publicly run school in Tokyo. At 12:15, preparations to serve lunch begin. Seven students from each class are assigned as lunch helpers. They put on sleeved aprons, hats, and masks to ensure good hygiene. The lunch helper's main task is to serve the food. They are careful to give each classmate an equal helping. School lunches don't offer a choice of food. Everyone eats the same meal. Usually, students dine in their own classrooms. In Japan, people say itadakimasu before they eat a meal. The lunch hour is a highlight of the school day for the children. What tasted best today? I like the fish. I used to leave some, but now I eat everything. Is lunchtime fun? Yes, because we all get to chat. At 1 p.m., lunch is over. Leftovers are returned to the serving pots and the used tableware neatly stacked. Milk boxes are flattened for disposal. Today, the students have left very little uneaten. Lunch procedures vary somewhat, but what happens at this school is pretty typical. This primary school has its own on-site kitchen. Food preparation begins at 7 a.m. They make meals for around 600 students. The meals are made completely from scratch. Seaweed is boiled in soy sauce in a big cauldron. Having an on-site kitchen allows meals to be served hot and fresh. It also helps the children feel more connected to the cooking of their meals. School lunch is expected to be a meal providing well-balanced nutrition, fish and vegetables, miso soup, and rice. On some days, bread or noodles will be served instead of rice, and meat instead of fish. And there is milk to drink. This is a typical school lunch. Keiko Ito is the school nutritionist in charge of developing the school's lunch menus. She takes into account what children are eating at home. We like to serve the students things that would be hard to cook at home. We like to serve items that require quite a lot of time and effort, as these might be regarded as tough to make at home. A school lunch menu must be designed to fulfill several criteria. It must ensure balanced nutritional content, but do so within a set budget for ingredients and time for preparation, using the equipment available in the kitchen. Meals are not always Japanese. Many other cuisines are represented. School lunches are made possible by careful concern for food and ingenuity in preparing meals.
I'm sure many of you will have been surprised to see children wearing white uniforms and even masks to serve lunch to their friends, and also to see them eating in their own classrooms. I should add that I was as surprised as you were the first time I saw that sight. This facility today has produced two different menus. It means that some schools will get this one, menu A, and some schools will get menu B. First of all, menu A here. You've got this rice dish here is mainly white rice, but with a little bit, about 5% of brown rice mixed in as well, for good measure. These little fish here, in Japanese, these are known as shishamo. It's a small saltwater fish that you can eat bones and all. Then this dish here, this is a curry-flavored stew, which has some pork, carrots, onions, peas, and some deep-fried tofu. Let's try some of this deep-fried tofu as well. That's pretty tasty. This is, it's well-balanced, and it actually tastes very good too. I'm impressed, I must say. But in addition to the nutritional factor, there's another, more philosophical element to Japanese school lunches too. Let's take a look at that next.
Lunch hour is a treat for school children. But the significance of school lunches in Japan goes beyond just eating lunch at school. School lunches are part of the education here, not separate from it. School lunch teaches children about their health, about nutrition, and about their bodies. A school lunch nourishes the mind as well as the body. That's what school lunch is all about. In 2005, Japan enacted a law on food and nutrition education. This law affirms the importance of children learning proper eating habits in life and promotes food education. In Japan, school lunches are being used to teach many lessons about food. The students gathered in front of this bulletin board during a break between lessons are school lunch officers. They assign the day's school lunch ingredients to their proper food groups, making it easy for the rest of the class to understand their nutritional value. It's a scheme of three basic food groups. Proteins and minerals that build the body, in red. Vegetables and fruit that keep the body in good working order, in green. And oils and grains that fuel the body, in yellow. This information about each day's school lunch teaches children about ingredients and their nutritional value. At this school, children also make announcements. Your school lunch officers here. Today's menu includes rice, milk, and miso soup. Milk is in the red food group, which contributes to your blood and builds your body. The students serving as school lunch officers describe the day's menu in detail. Now I'd like to tell you about the cold salad of dried fish fry and locally grown Japanese mustard spinach. The mustard spinach is supplied throughout the year by Mr. Tomizawa, a local grower here in Edogawa Ward. The neighborhood around the school is mainly residential, but there are farm plots scattered here and there. Japanese mustard spinach has been grown in the area for 400 years. Whenever the school lunch includes mustard spinach, like today, it always comes directly from a local farmer. It's an example of eating local. Schools in many areas are actively embracing the philosophy of eating local. It deepens awareness of local farm, forest, and fishery produce, and local culinary traditions and history. Eating local is one way in which school lunches are teaching children about food and promoting greater food self-sufficiency in Japan. There is also a food awareness building curriculum. Children develop their own menus to meet various criteria. Here's what the children wrote about the kind of school lunch they would like to eat. The plan includes lots of seasonal foods, yellowtail, daikon radish, mandarin oranges, and spinach. These items are delicious in the winter. The school created a menu based on this and prepared it for everyone to eat. For children, lunch hour is not only fun, but a window onto a wide world of knowledge from nutrition to local agriculture.
Back in my day, I don't think we had any idea where the food came from or what kind of nutritional value it had. I seem to remember at my school there was a dessert every day, and that being the best part of school lunch, in addition to it being a nice break from lessons and just being a time when you could enjoy being with your friends. So to me, it's quite interesting the degree of detail that the Japanese go to make children aware of the nutritional balance of what they're eating. Now it's time for the historical part of the show. We're going to take a look at when school lunches first appeared in Japan and how they've changed over the years.
The city of Tsuruoka in Yamagata Prefecture. A Buddhist temple here called Daitokuji was the birthplace of school lunches in Japan. In 1889, a school lunch was served for the first time to poor students attending the temple's primary school. It consisted of two rice balls, a cut of salmon, and pickles. Far simpler than today's school lunch menus. Over generations, the basic form of rice plus main dish, eaten with chopsticks, remained the same. Rice farming dates back to ancient times in Japan. Rice is the nation's staple food, and Japanese cuisine developed around it. As the custom of school lunches spread, the meals remain centered on the traditional staple, rice. But the start of the Pacific War in 1941 had a profound impact on school lunches in Japan. Here is an example of a school lunch from 1942. Food was scarce and rice largely unavailable, so the meal was nothing but a bowl of miso soup with wheat flour dumplings in it. When the war came to an end in 1945, Japan was suffering from severe food shortages. The following year, former US President Herbert Hoover visited Japan to evaluate the food situation. He advocated a proper system of school lunches throughout the country. Subsequently, the US Lara Food Aid Program, along with UNICEF, supplied powdered skimmed milk, wheat, and other food to Japan for use in school lunches. School lunches featuring these ingredients were introduced, targeting cities where food shortages were most acute. Here is a school lunch from 1947. It's a tomato stew made from imported tomato ketchup and milk made from powder. With American aid, school lunches became more filling, but their menu also imported Western eating habits. In 1954, the US enacted the Agricultural Trade Development and Assistance Act to expand consumption of American surplus farm products in Asia. 2 years later, the US began donating wheat and powdered milk for Japanese school lunches. This soon resulted in bread and powdered milk becoming standard in Japanese school lunches. In those days, children ate their school lunches with an implement called a spork, half spoon, half fork. Both the food and the utensils had become westernized. In the 1970s, changing eating habits in Japan resulted in surplus rice, and it became a national problem. A movement arose to protect this backbone of Japanese agriculture. Meanwhile, there was renewed appreciation of Japan's own cuisine, centered on rice. In 1976, rice finally made a comeback in school lunches. Also back in favor were chopsticks, once again considered a suitable utensil to use when eating school lunches. Nowadays, schools aim to include rice in lunch 3 times a week on average. School lunches in Japan began 120 years ago to feed poor, hungry students. The subsequent evolution of this food institution has mirrored Japan's changing society.
For many Japanese people, the expression school lunch conjures up nostalgic images of their childhood. And there are even some restaurants which play on that nostalgia and offer a kind of school lunch menu. Luckily, I'm joined by 4 people who actually grew up eating this food, and they're going to explain it for me, I hope. I'm told that this is a typical school lunch menu from the old days. Okay, let's all tuck in. Enjoy your meal. Itadakimasu.
Itadakimasu.
What's this here? Rather interesting looking hunk of bread.
This is fried bread. It's got soybean flour and sugar sprinkled on it. I remember that everyone was pretty excited on days when it was on the menu.
Next, these noodles, at least I think they're noodles. It's gone a bit cold. If it was warmer, it would probably be better. The curry's not bad, actually. This, which is warm. I mean, now that's a saucer of milk, which I would imagine perhaps a cat drinking out of.
It's skim milk made from powder. In the old days, it smelled really bad, and a lot of kids hated it.
We've heard on today's show how the whole school lunch thing is part of the learning experience in schools here. And this whole program today, for me, has been a big learning experience as well. But school lunches do have to be fun, and they have to taste good as well. And next, we're going to take a look at some recent initiatives to make school lunches really fun for the kids.
At this national tournament of school lunches, school nutritionists and cooks from all 47 prefectures in Japan compete to create school lunch menus that are delicious, nutritionally balanced, and appealing. The team from Gifu Prefecture mashes cooked rice and shapes it into molds, which are then sourced and baked. The result is a kind of rice cake, a traditional local dish. The judges have decided that on this occasion, Japan's best school lunch team hails from a primary school in Niigata Prefecture. The winning menu uses locally farmed vegetables and eggs, 20 ingredients in all. The skillful use of the ingredients scored high marks. What was the decisive factor in the win? The omelette, incorporating green peppers, onions and tomatoes, vegetables that many children tend to shy away from. The ingredients are chopped finely and mixed with the omelette, everyone's favorite, to bypass the objections of picky eaters. Because it's so difficult to cook omelets just right, schools often serve pre-prepared ones. But through a process of trial and error, this school's kitchen staff found a way to make large quantities in a short time by partially cooking the egg in a cauldron and then finishing it off in an oven. And what do the children think? It's great! School lunches feature all sorts of clever cookery. A primary school in Tokyo. At the morning assembly, two famous restaurant chefs make an appearance. Masahiro Kasahara runs a new wave Japanese restaurant in Tokyo. Iwao Asamizuya is the owner-chef of a French restaurant. These two chefs are collaborating with the school to develop new menus for the children. This project, where famous chefs collaborate with schools, is called Super Lunches by Super Chefs. Many first-class chefs representing a variety of cuisines are taking part in this event to promote food education. What do our two chefs hope to accomplish today? By having the children eat different foods from the ones they're used to, I hope to stimulate their interest in food. I often hear that today's kids leave their school lunches uneaten when it's Japanese cuisine. I'd like to make lunch an opportunity for them to have more knowledge of their own national cuisine. The menu devised by Kasahara uses a traditional turnip variety cultivated in centuries past in the local area. Recently, it has gradually been making a comeback. He chose it because the school requested a meal that would promote student awareness of eating local. Asamizuya, the French chef, is in charge of the soup. Some people find it difficult to imagine French cuisine in school lunches. But French cooking is not all about gourmet foods. It's about methods and how you handle ingredients. He decides to make a potage soup full of vegetables. He uses chopped pumpkin with the skin left on and turnips complete with leaves. It's his way of honoring the farmers who grew the vegetables. The lunch hour has finally arrived. Around 100 fifth grade students assemble in the lunchroom to sample today's super school lunch. Here is today's menu. Cod with turnips in a thick seaweed sauce. And a spicy soup. The turnips are fried without batter to give them a nice soft texture. The thick sauce contains plenty of warming seaweed. The spicy soup is packed with vegetables. Curry powder and coconut milk give the soup an interesting and unusual taste. Menu that two great chefs poured their hearts into. So, how does this special super school lunch taste? The thick sauce is great. It's fun to have something so different. The children love it. Plenty of them go in search of seconds, both the main dish and the soup. After lunch, the students have a chance to speak with the chefs. When did you start cooking? I started working as a cook when I was 19 years old. I graduated from high school and started training at a Japanese restaurant. What is the food you are best at making? Maybe not many of you eat this, but I'd say duck or pigeon. People eat that too. Maybe that seems mean, but they're delicious. Their opinions and feelings are so pure. Being around them makes me feel refreshed and ready to do my best cooking again tomorrow. The children said it was delicious and ate all their food, more than I expected. They enjoyed it and so did I. I'm glad I did it and I'd love to come again. For both the children and the chefs, the super school lunch has been a super cool experience.
We've seen on today's show how important school lunches are in Japan, but there are problems associated with them as well. One is that although they're generally pretty well thought out nutritionally, there can be problems of balancing the flavors. There's also an economic issue. The price of ingredients is on the rise, and although schools do charge for school lunches, some people can't afford to pay, and other people, although they can afford to, don't want to, and that's a problem as well. There's even been talk of scrapping school lunches altogether, but in addition to the educational value that we've seen on the program today, there's also the issue that many, many children have both of their parents at work in the day, and because of that, there's more demand than ever for school lunches. We've seen how they've changed through the years, and presumably that will continue to be the case. I'll see you again next time.